The Hermitage ranks among the biggest and oldest museums in the world. It boasts nearly 3 million monuments of art and culture, including painting, sculpture, graphic, decorative, and applied art. The Hermitage collection covers the entire history of world culture, ranging from antiquity to our present time, from the primitive culture of the Stone Age and the ancient Oriental civilizations of Egypt, Assyria, and Babylon, to European art of the 20th century. The Hermitage is an architectural ensemble of 4 buildings housing over 350 halls. The history of the Hermitage implies also the history of the buildings themselves. Founded in the 18th century as a palace museum for Russian emperors, the buildings of the Hermitage were built near the residence of the Russian Tsars, the Winter Palace, in the following order: the Small Hermitage, the Big or Old Hermitage, the Hermitage Theater, and the New Hermitage. The Department of Western European Art, including its celebrated picture gallery, is the oldest and the largest in the Hermitage. The collections occupy over 100 rooms, which represents 1/3 of the museum's exposition space, and cover a period from the 11th to the 20th century. Almost all Western countries and the great masters are represented. Among the highlights are works by Leonardo da Vinci, Raphael, Titian, Rembrandt, Rubens, Van Dyck, Poussin, Watteau, Ingres, and Delacroix, as well as paintings by Impressionists and Post-Impressionists. The department possesses over 600,000 prints and drawings, a brilliant collection of objects of applied arts, and a fine collection of sculpture. The history of the department goes back to the 18th century. During this time, it was common to purchase large groups of paintings, sometimes complete galleries, at sales in Western Europe. Diplomatic representatives were instructed by Catherine II to provide information about forthcoming sales. The founding of the Hermitage is usually taken to be the year 1764. When a collection of 225 paintings by Dutch and Flemish painters were bought in Berlin from the Gutskowski collection. They were soon followed by many others. Count Brühl's collection was bought in Dresden. This collection included a great number of engravings, drawings, and over 600 canvases by Italian, French, Dutch, and German painters. The gallery of Pierre Creusot was purchased in Paris. Among his masterpieces were paintings by Raphael, Rembrandt, Rubens, Tintoretto, and Snyders. The Walpole collection arrived from London. The purchase of the collection gave the Hermitage excellent Flemish paintings and Van Dyck's works of his English period. The Cobenzl collection, bought in Brussels, laid the foundation for the museum's repository of 4,000 drawings. A collection of antique sculpture was purchased from John Lyde Brown. A famous statue contained within the collection was The Crouching Boy by Michelangelo. Among notable additions made to the picture gallery in the 19th century were paintings acquired in Paris from the Malmaison Gallery of the Empress Josephine. The most precious were paintings by Rembrandt and Claude Lorraine. The collection of the banker Korsfeldt, consisting mainly of Spanish paintings, was a significant addition to the Hermitage Museum. Canvases from the Barbarigo Palace in Venice gave the museum its best Titians. Other important acquisitions include the Litter Madonna by Leonardo da Vinci and Raphael's Conestabile Madonna, which were bought in Italy. The collection of Alexander Basilevsky was exceptionally rich in medieval and Renaissance materials. It enriched the museum with rare pieces of Byzantine, Islamic, and Western European applied art. The last large collection, which was purchased before World War I, contained over 700 Dutch and Flemish paintings, systematically gathered specially for the Hermitage by the Russian geographer Semyonov Tienshansky. These were sold by him to the museum for half their value. According to the well-known collector Kitrovo's will, the Hermitage received his collection of 18th century English portraits. The year 1914 witnessed the purchase of Leonardo da Vinci's Madonna with the Flower from the Benoit family. After the 1917 revolution, a considerable number of works of art were received by the Hermitage from nationalized royal palaces, including the Winter Palace. These entries to the Hermitage enlarged the sections of Western European painting and sculpture, drawings and engraving, coins and medals. A number of applied arts from the Baron Steglitz collection was transferred to the Hermitage. The collection contained the richest volume of Western European art from the Middle Age to the late 19th century. In 1948, there was a very special transfer to the Hermitage of more than 300 canvases, sculptures, and prints from the disembodied Moscow Museum of New Western Art. The Moscow Museum was founded after the Revolution from the collections of well-known Moscow benefactors Nikolai and Sergei Shukins and Ivan and Mikhail Morozovs, and consisted primarily of art by Impressionists and Post-Impressionists. Through this acquisition, the Hermitage collection of Impressionistic works became one of the largest in the world.
The crowned Mary, standing with a golden halo, the archangel Michael, who is weighing the good and the bad deeds of a soul, the youth who is depicted as a holy knight with heart and sword, all these figures are embroidered brilliantly, and the naive, detailed narrative calls to mind folk embroidery.
Thank you.
In the representation of this theme, the artist used an allegorical formula. As a childish-looking angel unsuccessfully tries to pour the water from the sea into a small pit, so St. Augustine's insight into the transcendental mystery of the Trinity is insufficient because of his human nature. Very interesting is the artist's absorption with problems of linear perspective. He even attempted to calculate the sea, which is getting narrow in the distance.
The term Renaissance appeared in the 15th century to signify the rebirth of classical erudition. In the mid-15th century, it had already established an application for renovated representative arts. Later, the classification of Renaissance art was elaborated, and this early period was called Quattrocento, or the Early Renaissance. In the 15th century, too, Florence was ahead of other artistic centers. New great artists appeared here, such as Masaccio in painting, Donatello in sculpture, and Brunelleschi in architecture. All of them can be considered the fathers of the Renaissance, and Florence itself as the New Athens. The rendering of three-dimensional space by means of linear perspective, which was based on the laws of optics and mathematics, became the most important discovery of the masters of the Renaissance. Fra Filippo Lippi used the linear perspective scheme in a small part of his altarpiece, the so-called predella, with the vision of St. Augustine. It is notable that he even attempted to calculate the sea, which is getting narrow in the distance. He investigated the allegorical meaning of the vision with great visual insistence. The Trinity was represented in the form of a disc with three faces. St. Augustine's attempt to obtain an insight into the transcendental mystery of the Trinity is unsuccessful in exactly the same way as an angel tries to pour water from the sea into a small pit.
It seems that we have just attracted the attention of the child. He seemingly looks at us sidelong, and the lips of Mary have just taken on a tender smile, so imperceptible are the light shadows in the corners of her mouth. Leonardo displayed how to build, by means of chiaroscuro, not only the volumes, but also the slightest emotions, as if they were woven of the tonal shades.
Thank you.
In the second half of the 18th century, there appeared a new artistic trend in Rome, that of neoclassicism. It reflected a new wave of interest in ancient culture, which spread through many European countries. Roman neoclassicism took superficial artistic formulas from the ancients, and the classic purity of form was tinted now by sentimentality, now by the erotic connotations of the surviving Rococo style. The most famous sculptor of the late 18th, early 19th century, Antonio Canova, lived and worked in Rome. He acted as dictator of artistic tastes, and his imagery soon was praised as a model of beauty. He was invited to France by Napoleon, and to Russia by Catherine II and Alexander I. Canova refused the trip to Russia, but the Russian ambassador, Count Yusupov, returned to St. Petersburg with his statuary, Amour and Psyche, which was the author's variant of the statue in the Louvre. According to legend, the goddess Venus took a dislike to Psyche because of her beauty and arranged an eternal sleep for her. Amour returned her to life with a kiss. Canova sought to achieve the classical harmony of proportions and fluid outlines, but these formulas often took on a gracious and coddled form in his work.
The Madonna by Cranach looks like a princess with golden hair, as if she were taken from old German legends. Cranach set down time and time again the ideal type of female beauty of the period, the bulging forehead, narrow and wide-spaced eyes, oval face with sharp chin, and long curly hair. Thank you.
The experience of the Barbizon school opened not only the new, actual motifs for landscape painting, but contributed to the evolving of a new pictorial technique by loose brushing. Plein air painting was a starting point of this trend, and soon the moment came in the history of French art when the young artist Claude Monet is said to have repeated, following the Barbizon artists, "I paint what I see," but to have added, "and I paint so how I see." This was the starting point of Impressionism. Monet had no permanent studio, for the sky above and the ground beneath became his actual studio. The Lady in the Garden is his earlier painting of 1867. We can see the moving flowers charged with bright light and the long, mobile shadows. The white dress is painted with blue in the shadows, for it was here the true hue created by the shadow from the orange-yellow umbrella. In the autumn of 1876, Monet lived in the country house of his friend and patron, Dr. Rochide, at Montgeron. From the early morning, one could see him there near the pond and the blooming brushwood, working at one of his huge canvases. He painted quickly in order not to omit all details of the changing lighting. Monet did not draw in the academic sense of this word. Drawing was not the object of his artistic conscience. Monet achieved a scintillating, fresh range of tones when applying them pure in minute touches to the white ground of the canvas. Such canvas, seen at a short distance, seemed to be a plain surface covered with innumerable and irregular colored patches, but at some distance from the canvas, they miraculously turned into mobile image throbbing with life and excitement, with swinging flowers, fleeting ripples, quivering verdure. To represent at one stroke the changing pulsation of life, and to get the immediate connection between the painter's eye perceiving nature's color and the canvas surface bearing his pigment's equivalent, without turning either to any conception of content or to literary subject. It was the new method of working at the painting, as well as the art, which had to render the mentality of the mid-19th century. It was the discovery of Claude Monet. But it was also the outcome of the life of a whole group of men. Alfred Sisley painted his picture in the Hermitage collection, the town Villeneuve-la-Garenne, in 1872. It displays the living and immense space, imbued with light and air. But the impressionist brushwork of the artist created the volumes with solid forms of the tree trunks and houses of the provincial French town.
Almost cubist planes dominate in the treatment of the woman's figure. All the edges of these planes converge inwards, except those of the fan, opening outwards. Such a grotesque rendering borders on the tragic. In spite of the monumentalism of the forms, this figure suggests extreme inner tension. Being locked within the outline of the armchair, this lady with a fan remains shrunk into herself. Once Goya said he had three teachers, life, Velázquez, and Rembrandt. All these lessons are present in the portrait of the actress Antonia Serrate, whose image is noble, psychologically deep, and full of life. Goya's particular thrilling of emotions and passionate flickering of light, handled by his brush and color manner, are to be considered as a foretoken of the near Romanticism.
The work of Goya belonged to the 18th century as much as to the 19th. His highly original talent made him an outstanding master of world art. I had three teachers, life, Velázquez, and Rembrandt. These words of the painter are applicable to the portrait of the actress Antonia Serrate. Goya enriched the lessons of his teachers with passionate and mobile emotionalism. The portrait preserved forever the name and appearance of the actress Antonia Serrate. Her beauty is noble and delicate. We can quite clearly suppose that its soul was equally subtle and delicate. Her big dark eyes are imbued with inner fire and sadness. This portrait can be considered as one of the first images of Romanticism, a portrait of a mood.
In his late period, Murillo painted his most famous images of the Virgin. He took her features from the actual women of Andalusia, and thus glorified their beauty. The subtlety of his pictorial means gave the name to that period of his work, aerial, vaporoso.
There are two works from the hand of Leonardo da Vinci in the Hermitage. He began that period of the Italian Renaissance, which was called, later, the High Renaissance. He was the first to combine his observations of nature with the most lofty ideals and generalizations. Madonna with a Flower, Madonna Benoit, is the earliest of the surviving works of Leonardo. A notice on his drawing in the Uffizi gave the precise date, 1478. The chief impression this picture evokes is not its genre element, but the natural analysis of the inner world of a man, the awakening of consciousness in a child. The child is interesting himself in a flower, as if being in a normal, childish relationship with the world. The face of Mary, whose dress and hair are done in the latest Florentine fashion of that time, is marked by a placid smile. The natural gestures combine the characters into a unified group. For the first time in the art of the Renaissance, we see how convincingly the interplay of light and half-shadow creates the well-rounded forms, as well as filling the pictorial space with luminosity and airiness. The technique of oil painting, borrowed from the Netherlands, allowed the extreme elusiveness of the painted objects to be reached. Madonna and Child, Madonna Litta, was finished by Leonardo in Milan, where he moved in 1482. In the Madonna Litta, the perfection and harmony of bodily beauty and purely spiritual beauty is impressive. With its precise outlines, it recalls ancient marble pieces. All the elements, including the color scheme, are well balanced. This quite distinctive sculptural manner was characteristic of the Florentine school. The method of chiaroscuro provides softness of all the volumes and facial features. The lips of Mary have just taken on a tender smile, so imperceptible are the light shadows in the corners of her mouth. Leonardo was capable of creating, by means of light and shade, not only volumes, but also the slightest emotions. By the last decade of the 19th century, the dominant role of the Impressionist trend was over. In this period of post-Impressionism, several great names appeared in France: Cézanne, Van Gogh, Gauguin. That foreshadowed the giddy changes in the art of the near 20th century. Their work was not appreciated for its true worth by their contemporaries. Such a painting as Young Girl at the Piano by Cézanne displays no obvious connections with Impressionist conception, which the artist followed in the late 1860s, except in its exaggerated non-academical manner and the modern subject. A room in the native house of the artist at Aix-en-Provence, with figures of his mother sitting on a sofa and his sister at the piano. The color palette was dark and heavy, and was distant from the luminous colors of the Impressionists. Even in the circle of his associates, this strange provincial was an outsider, as well as at salons where his paintings were not accepted, being always rejected with great indignation. While working at plein air with Pissarro, at Pontus and Auvers, Cézanne absorbed the Impressionist technique. There he painted his self-portrait, represented as a bearded, shaggy man with a fevered look whose face was aged prematurely because of inner storms and solitude. The Impressionist technique could not banish the strong originality of Cézanne. He was capable of endowing his canvases with the heat of the southern noon and the freshness of mountain air. His analysis of color and tone, combined with strong, short brush strokes, created not only the interplay of light and shadows sliding along the tree trunk and over the grass and yellow soil, he considered color as a means of modeling, and can perceive the inner force of this tree with its twigs and dense needles, of the soil, mountains, and air of Provence. Cézanne's color is the living substance of all objects. The soft apples, his favorite motif, dense fabrics and stiff napkins in his still life piece. The living personages display the same powerful material substance as we can see in the strong figure of the peasant, whose brick-red face, burnt with sun, reminds us of the soil or the old houses in Provence, and whose heavy hands call to mind the matured fruits from the trees cultivated by these hands. Impregnated with the powerful forces of the earth, he is an integral part of nature itself, and this personage needs no proper name, which is why he is only Pipe Smoker, an image of a man as a creation of nature.
Medieval craftsmen displayed outstanding skill in combining the expressiveness of allegorical struggles between good, here the knight, and evil, here the dragon, with the specific forms of everyday objects. In this bronze ablution vessel, two knights' locks of hair, done in the fashion of that time, serve as two spouts for water. This ablution vessel, for ceremonial occasions, incorporates the lion's image as a symbol of secular power. The classic shape conforms to the rather austere though elegant ornament. Near the castle of Duke Heinrich Durlow in Braunschweig, a lion's effigy was erected, which became a model for many objects of applied art. This ablution vessel incorporates the figures of Aristotle, standing on all fours, and Campaspe, who is riding on his back. This affirms woman's power over man. Campaspe was a renowned courtesan during the rule of Alexander of Macedonia, whose teacher was the philosopher Aristotle. Her beauty is difficult to determine here because of the typically medieval schematicism of the representation.